Thank you. Are there people watching? Into the live stream, so I have to talk very loudly. So hopefully you all can hear me. And thank you for coming tonight. My name is Rachel Adams. I'm the Chief Curator and Director of Programs at the Bemis Center, where you are. And welcome to Soundtracks for the Present Future. First, I want to let everyone know that we're actually recording this, so the least amount of sound you can make during the performance would be much appreciated, but I know that it happens, so don't hold your breath, just hold your breath. First, before I start, I just want to thank Charley Friedman for this amazing piece. I think it was in January, and I knew that you were working on this, but I didn't really know until you posted a short video, and then I immediately texted you, and I said, we need to talk. And Andy and I drove to Lincoln, and that was it, and now we're here. So I'm just super grateful for the work that you've done, for your amazing soul, and just everything. So thank you so much, Charley. After the performance, we're going to do a short Q&A conversation with Charley and Paul and Luke Farritor, who is somewhere. Oh, there he is right next to Charley, who was the exhibition engineer who helped create this constellation. So stay tuned for that. And as you may have seen from the exhibition intro or online, this plays itself while the exhibition is open. So come back tomorrow or any other day until August 1st when we're open so you can experience all the different compositions that Charley has worked with so many local composers, some of which are here tonight, including Derek Higgins. Is it Greg that's here? Or Tom Larson, or Nicholas. I'm so sorry. There's three of you, and I keep forgetting. Nicholas LeMay. And then Jeremy Toussaint Baptiste is somewhere also. Our current Bemis sound artists in residence, and also Greg Simon, Tom Larson, Jay Carlson, and Marcus Fisher, who is an artist in the, oh my goodness, I just completely blanked on the title of the show in the front galleries, Altogether Amongst Many Reflections on Empathy. He was here last week, was so inspired, immediately wrote something for the piece, and we added that in. So you can come back and listen to all of those at your leisure, but only until August 1st, so definitely get here because the summer is going to fly. I also want to thank the staff of the Bemis Center, especially Andy Garlock, wherever he is, running our sound. Andy worked extremely hard with Charley and Luke to install this piece and also to work with all the composers and get everything running and up and lit. So thank you so much, Andy. We really appreciate everything that you do here. I also want to thank Jerry Banks Group for their support of the exhibition and Andrew W. Mellon Foundation for their support of the performances. We would not be here without them. And then I'm just gonna do a little bit about each Charley and Paul, and then we'll begin. So Charley Friedman is a Pollock Krasner Grant recipient and a two-time Rima Hort nominee and a Smack Mellon Hot Picks artist. Friedman has exhibited and performed extensively at galleries and institutions internationally, including MoMA PS1, the Queen's Museum, Crystal Bridges Museum of American Art, OMI International Arts Center, the Fabric Workshop, Barbara Mathis Gallery, Volta New York City, the Joslin Art Museum here in Omaha, the Sheldon Museum in Lincoln, and the Museum of Nebraska Art in Kearney. Charley's work is in the collections of the Walker Art Center, the Brooklyn Museum, the New York Public Library, Stanford University, the Sheldon Museum, and the Duncan Collection, which is in Lincoln. And his work has been included in publications such as the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Miami Herald. He received his Master's of Fine Arts from the School of the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston / Tufts University, and also attended Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture in 1995. And he received his BFA from McAllister College in St. Paul, Minnesota. He is a Bemis alumni. He's done residencies at Bemis, as well as the Fountainhead, the Norton Island Residency, McDowell, and PV Arts. And as many of you know, Charley lives in Lincoln with his lovely wife, Nancy, and they co-founded and co-curate Fiendish Plots. So, and I think that's coming back soon, so keep an eye out for that. So thank you again, Charley. Praised by the New York Times for his Listian thunder and deft fluidity, and the San Francisco Chronicle as ferociously virtuistic, pianist Paul Barnes has electrified audiences with his intensely expressive playing and cutting-edge programming. He has been featured 7 times on APM's Performance Today, on the cover of Clavier magazine, and his recordings are streamed worldwide. Celebrating his 25-year collaboration with Philip Glass, Barnes commissioned and gave the world premiere of Glass's Piano Quintet Annunciation. Barnes's latest recital, A Bright Sadness, piano music inspired by Greek, Latin, Hebrew, and Native American chant, features a contemplative and cathartic program of piano works inspired by the mystical world of chant. Barnes gave this live recital at New York Symphony Space, which featured the world premiere of Victoria Bond's Illuminations on Byzantine Chant, which Barnes recorded in May of 2021. Barnes is the Marguerite Scribante Professor of Music at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln Glenn Korff School of Music. He was recently appointed the Artistic Director of the Lead Center Piano Academy, which will be held July 11th through 16th of this summer. And Barnes's recordings are available on Spotify, Pandora, iTunes, Apple Music, YouTube, and Amazon. And he also has some CDs, so he can talk about that later if you're interested. I think that may be it. I'm sorry I had my back to all of you. This is fun to be in the round here. And I think we're gonna start. So welcome everybody virtually as well, and welcome Paul Barnes.
Favorite rag. So this is Trinity. Trinity, I first of all have to acknowledge the remarkable engineering wizardry of Luke Farritor. Because at the beginning of this project, it would have been inconceivable for me to play my transcription of Philip Glass's Einstein on the Beach, because the 16 notes went too fast and the latency between the keyboard and the guitars was too great. But somehow Luke solved that problem. And thank you, Luke. So as a result, we can have all of these fast, exciting pieces on the program. So, and I just wanted to mention a little bit about this Trinity, simply, particularly the last piece. It's my favorite Scarlatti sonata, by the way. But the last piece, the Clara Schumann prelude, was the very first thing that I played back in 1995 on my job interview and for the University of Nebraska. So that piece is probably what got me hired, because it's a glorious work, and I'm thrilled to include a work by Clara Schumann on tonight's program. So this is the second Trinity. Thank you. of one of the glass etudes that he wrote. As Rachel mentioned, I will be selling my CDs after the performance tonight, and I've recorded all of the glass you've heard tonight in one CD or another. This was on my New Generation CD where I selected seven of his etudes. And this number 18 was one of my absolute favorites. The Couperin just fit this piece like a glove. It's the perfect Baroque minimalist piece, and so I was just thrilled to include that. And of course, with guitars, there had to be some sort of representation of blues, and so I selected the Samuel Barber. So this is the third tune.
Thank you.
a work that you all know. One of the things I wanted to be sure that I did in programming was to make sure that you heard a few familiar pieces with completely new ears that you're going to hear tonight next to Charley's installation. So the very beautiful C major prelude. And then the final piece is a work by my dear friend. For those of you that might have seen me play the Philip Glass Piano Concerto, Ron Warren is my go-to guy. He is the greatest Native American flute player on the planet, and he's a glorious composer. And so his work is even more perfect for this instrument than it is for the piano, because it's an alteration between two world views. One is an objective view of nature, and the other is a human response to that objective view of nature. And the image that he had for the objective nature versions were like wind chimes. So they have all of these isolated voices popping in and out. And so those sections are pure magic on this particular work. So this is the final trilogy.
Thank you.
so we're going to project, but we're going to talk into microphones for the stream. So thank you, Paul. That was amazing. Amazing. Thank
My
you.
Pleasure.
Can we get another round of applause, please? So we have Paul, we have Charley, we have Luke here, and I just want to open it up. This is going to be a convo. But Charley, can we just start? Like, where did this idea come from? Like, tell everybody.
Okay. Well, it appeared about 10 years ago in my sketchbook. And I'm always drawing and thinking about new ideas, and so they all go in there. But my work is primarily in concerned with the overriding theme is how we perceive information that comes to us, either collectively or as individuals. And that's often could be symbols or messages or materials around us. Music is one of those things that we have that goes directly into our bodies. And I wanted to make a piece that somehow bounds between the individual and the collective public and make a piece where you would enter into it in a very non-linear way. You could leave at however way you choose. So for me, that led to an installation, and that led to an installation made of guitars, because guitars are the most ubiquitous instrument we have in this country. And everybody has them. Or they're in, you either know how to play them, or they're in your closet, they were given to you. So that kind of dictated the materials, and then I just went from there.
It's amazing that I think, you know, I was doing a talk last night with one of our alums, Kambui, and we talked about how ideas resonate for such a long time sometimes, and or sometimes they come to fruition really quickly. And I feel like for this installation, it was something that obviously, yeah, like you said, it appeared 10 years ago in your sketchbook, and it sort of slowly, you know, marinated, and then you did a Kickstarter for it and raised money, and you know, and then all of a sudden it's now here, and now it might go other places, right? And so like how the timing of that is really interesting, I think, in comparison to like the time when people are like sitting in this or walking through it and like hearing things like over there and wanting to go towards it and then hearing something behind them or in front of them, or you know, it kind of ping-pongs around. And I feel like that's sort of almost how this piece kind of came to fruition too.
Completely, and you have to make it, at least I wanted to attempt to make something that seemed effortless, but behind all this was a body of technology and engineering, which I credit Luke Farritor here for helping me manipulate this whole kind of bit of information.
Yeah, so Luke, do you want to talk about how you and Charley first started working together, and him coming to you and saying, this is what I want to do, and you saying, what exactly?
Yeah, so I think the first thing I said was, what? Did I get it? You know? He basically came to me with this idea, lots of guitars, all playing together, and then we just kind of put our heads together, you know, how do we make that a reality? First, we made a small prototype, you know, just a couple of guitars, used that to raise money. We got involved with a couple other people, like Jay Carlson, I think he's over there.
Jay.
He deserves a shout out. He deserves a pause. But he was a big part of this, and then, you know, it's just kind of, you know, it's a really interesting engineering challenge because, you know, if you get one working, you know, that's great. If it's working on your workbench, now you got to multiply that by 59, you know? But it was a really great challenge.
So can you summarize how it actually works?
Yeah, so it all starts at the piano. You don't have to just plug a piano in. You can plug in a computer, which is what we do when we don't have Paul here. And then that is basically those music signals using something called MIDI. That's like the language computers use to talk to each other about music. That's sent all throughout these cables you see on the floor. And then that goes into these little circuit boards you can see on each guitar. Those process the signals, run the little motor, and then kind of make it all happen.
So my son, who was watching for a little bit, asked, why is that green and why is that red? The lights. Sometimes the light on the guitar is red and sometimes it's green, and he was curious about that. So I told him I would ask.
Yeah, it's a good question. One day I was ordering parts and I said, I'll buy green lights. And the next day I was ordering parts and I said, I'll buy red lights. So there's not much rhyme or reason to that.
Well, then he'll be excited. He likes green, so he was very excited about the green ones. Okay, so I think that kind of answers that question on how it works a little bit. Mm-hmm. But Charley, when did you decide to bring Paul into the picture?
Right.
Talk about that.
So the key to this whole thing was the interface. How is the music, how are we gonna get great music or great sound? And a composer or a musician can only do this. I'm not a musician. So a musician or a composer can only enter into the system through an interface that feels user-friendly. So Luke and I and Jay over there were sitting around and we kind of came to this idea. We had kind of made a certain logic in the instrument and it wasn't working. And we decided that it needed to be more like a pipe organ. So once we decided that and that a piano or MIDI keyboard would be the interface and that every note on the keyboard would go to a solo guitar, then it opened up. And then we realized that it would work the way I had imagined it. And that's when I texted Paul and said, "Yo, Paul!" And it was a very rudimentary text, a little video, maybe of Luke or Jay playing something. And within an hour, Paul texted back and said, "I'm in. Let me come over. Let's see how this thing works." And then, as you were saying to Luke, then we asked you about how we could fine tune this so you could actually do a recital.
Yeah.
And how can we have a basically something that acts as an instrument if we want it? And then after that, I decided to invite composers. So Derek Higgins, Greg Simon, Nicholas Lemmy, and Tom Larson all joined. And then we had some Bemis artists who also joined too, Jeremy Toussaint-Baptiste and Marcus Fisher. So it became this thing that people kind of wanted to be a part of. And so they all came to the studio and I said, "Here's the key. I'm not gonna be here. You just do your thing because you have to now navigate through this." And I kind of gave a list of parameters that I was interested in, but it has its own sonic reach and it's not gonna behave like a traditional instrument because ultimately it's an experiential piece that people have to participate with and go through it. So your E's not gonna be over here and your F's not gonna be over there.
And Paul, what, when you got that initial text and first spent time in the studio with Charley, like what were you thinking? Like, well, have you ever experienced this before?
Yeah, my wheels were spinning because I always like really creative projects that are, you know, somewhat out of the box, and this definitely fits the bill for that. And so the challenge for me was finding music that would work with, you know, with the interface, you know, because there's no dynamics, you know. And so, because I'm a big part of my life is teaching. I know a bunch of my students were here at one time or another. And one of the big things is dynamics and voicing and things like that. So when you remove that, because once you hit it, it just simply switches the thing, then you have to figure out different ways of being expressive. And I hope you felt that I was expressive tonight. I sure felt like I was. I was having a ball. But it was simply because of what you can do with time. And time is an unbelievable expressive component and texture. So I couldn't do pieces where there were really thick left-handed parts because those would clearly outbalance the melody. And so I went through 400 or 500 years of music and came up with, you know, tonight's program that I wanted it to be very, very diverse from the communities that composed it, but then also from its emotive message, and then things that would actually work on here. And so we tried a billion pieces, you know, and it was really clear, that's not working, that's not gonna work, this works, you know. And so there were certain pieces, and we did find, as I wrote in the program notes, did everybody read the program notes, I hope? In any event, nobody reads program notes. What we found was that minimalist aesthetic, you know, like Philip Glass, things that had very, very slow processes, and much of the Baroque as well, worked perfectly, you know? And so it just came together in a very, very beautiful way.
Yeah, I think when I first, when Andy and I came down and you played for us, then it felt very, yeah, like I immediately it brought me back to my, I think I was watching Bridgerton at that point. Like, there was a lot of, like, the harpsichord feeling really does, you know, get you immediately. Yeah. You sort of think about that, those periods.
Yeah.
And we had someone here last week, and he said he felt like he was inside of a music box.
Yeah.
And I felt like that was such a great way to describe it if you are not able to experience it, but you can kind of put yourself inside of a music box and be like, and feel every single note that's happening, you know? I thought that was a really great way to describe it, so.
Very much so.
I think that it's obviously experiential. We obviously want more people to come down and experience it, but I'm interested, I'm not checking my phone, but I'm interested if there's anyone chatting, like what they, you know, what it looks like actually, like how it feels virtually is kind of an interesting thing. Yeah. So we'll have to like check that later and see. But yeah, I don't know, Charley, what are you thinking now? It's up, like how do you feel? Like what's going through your head? What's the next thing that you're thinking about?
Well, it's interesting because, you know, I've never done a piece quite like this where I needed to collaborate with so many different individuals. And that was a really kind of powerful thing in and of itself. And because everybody brings their own unique characters, personalities, but also talents to the whole piece. And that was really marvelous. At the same token, this piece is a performative object. And so what I look forward to is when people come to the Bemis is that they actually decide that they kind of leave their preconceptions about how they should feel or think about something and just navigate through it and listen to your body, listen to your emotions, and how the music is entering in your body. What I love about, one of the things I love is how the kind of serendipitous thing where you'll walk by something and you'll the plectrum will hit a guitar that you're next to, and that's just the way it is. And I really love that. You have no control over those aspects, which of course is kind of a metaphor for how we navigate life.
Yep.
I think that's a great way to end. Thank you again all for coming tonight, and thank you everyone who's joining us from the virtual stream. And please come down to Bemis. Like I said, this is up until August 1st. Plenty of time. We'll have another performance July 29th, so right before it closes, where Paul will perform again. Jeremy Toussaint-Baptiste will perform, and but definitely come down during the week or on the weekends. We're now open on Sundays, everybody. Very exciting. And really, you know, it's I personally love experiencing it. You know, I mean, we always have hundreds of thousands of visitors to Bemis all the time, but there are some moments where you might just be you in here, and that's pretty spectacular. So I definitely suggest coming back.
Rachel, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Really, thank you so much. And Bemis, too.
Okay. Thanks, everyone. Good night.
And for anybody interested, I will be signing CDs over at the CD table.